Welcome back to the Sunday edition right here in KTN News. We're glad you've stayed with us. Now let's shift gears to something different, but it's still within the political scene, and it's all about the hugs, the handshakes that have characterized Kenya's political scene. And we have a senior political reporter, Patrick Kamimo, who has packaged for us with regards to the national prayer meeting where Raila Odinga, former prime minister, and of course President Uhuru Kenyatta, extended their handshakes to their deputies, that is Deputy President William Ruto and Kalonzo Musyoka.
The 16th anniversary of the National Prayer Breakfast that is organized by Parliament brought together people from all walks of life. The prayers came at a time when the country appears to be under the grip of corruption cartels that are unashamedly looting public resources. Aware of the fury sparked by the outright theft and embezzlement of state coffers, leaders say the corrupt must be punished for their crimes.
Surely we can come together and fight corruption and not use our tribe, ethnicity and our religion to hide behind negative acts. A thief is a thief. He's not a Luo, he's not a Kikuyu, he's not a Kalenjin, he has a name.
And that's the reason why the current campaign that's going on to fight the vice that is one of our major enemies, corruption, has our full support.
The leader said political differences should not be used to divide the country. They agreed to build bridges and support realization of the Big Four agenda that includes tackling unemployment, provision of universal health care, and decent housing.
People will never always agree on everything. And we will have differences in terms of political opinion. We can agree to disagree and move forward.
As we build the bridges of friendship, brotherhood, and unity, we must remember to resist hate, to refuse disunity, and to say no to a negative ethnicity.
Somalia President Mohamed Abdullah Farmajo said terrorism was still a threat in the region. President Uhuru Kenyatta promised Kenya would work closely with Somalia to restore peace in the war-ravaged country.
When they attack non-Muslims or Christians in Kenya, their intention is to create division between Muslims and Christians in Kenya. So Christians would retaliate and attack back to good and peace-loving Muslims in this great country. We don't need to fall in that trap. And we have to understand that Al-Shabaab is our common enemy.
Those who attended the prayers agreed corruption was tainting the country's image and must be fought from all fronts.
The biggest challenge and where we can lose the battle is forgetting the reforms in the public sector. We have abandoned the reforms in the public sector. We no longer have a value-driven public sector. And that must be done. We must go back to the basics, go back to the reforms initiated by the NAR government in 2003. Let every ministry restore the performance contracting. Let every officer in the government be held accountable.
If the Chief Justice says they are ready to support the judiciary, we want to see real support. Top-notch lawyers normally argue cases in court, protecting and arguing for the accused. We want to see our prosecutor doing that for the monarchy. Yeah, giving all the facts to the extent that the judiciary, the judge will find no doubts to be able to deliver what is lawful for our people.
We've seen the leaders hug and forgive each other and pledge to work for the unity of the country. Will they walk the talk? That remains to be seen. Patrick Amimo, KTN News, Nairobi.
Thank you, Amimo, for that report. A lot has been said, a lot have been discussed about the politics of handshake, especially now that both Deputy President William Ruto and Kalonzo Musyoka are now in the picture. But now let me just focus on one man, and that is NASA. Shall I say NASA leader, the opposition leader, Raila Odinga? And these are some interesting facts here. Let me start with you, Dismas. Apparently, he has assumed a new role of that of an elder statesman. Mr. Odinga has been to South Sudan, apparently in a bid to bring President Salva Kiir and his rival Riek Machar to the negotiating table. He's also going to head to South Africa this week for a two-day mission on South Sudan. And then since the handshake on March 9th, Mr. Odinga has been given a pride of place in national functions. You've seen that during the Madaraka Day celebrations. And now the former prime minister has enhanced security and is received by government officials abroad. It seems we don't have an opposition any longer.
Well, you know, for the longest time, Mr. Raila Odinga has been the symbol of opposition in Kenya. Even when he's in an Usumkate administration, he's an enigma, he's an institution, and he has really fought for the nation. But when you look at the events happening in the last couple of days, at some stage, Mr. Raila Odinga will be required to take a decision as to whether he still wants to continue being the opposition chief in Kenya, or he wants to assume his new international profile, you know, with all the necessities that is required to that office. Because there's no way you're going to be playing local politics in Nairobi, fighting corruption in Nairobi, you know, attending all these meetings in Mombasa with Governor Joe, and at the same time assume your international role. All the successful international statesmen, like coming from Nigeria, that's there is Olusegun Obasanjo, there is Thabo Mbeki, there was Nelson Mandela before he passed on. They divorced themselves from the local politics mm-hmm. and assumed an international role. Because at some stage, when President Kenyatta is sending Raila Odinga to go and represent him in South Africa at an mm-hmm. international meeting, he's not sure on whose script will he be playing. Is he going there to represent Kenya as a nation, or is he going there to discuss party issues? So in my view, probably it's a good time for Raila Odinga to say that it's been nice doing local politics. Mm-hmm. I've had enough. Mm-hmm. Let me now stay at the national level and engage in some succession planning at the local level in Kenya. But again, when you go back to the handshake, it's now very clear who are the beneficiaries of the handshake, because it's after this handshake that Raila Odinga finds himself in these international assignments, that he finds himself with enhanced security. Never mind that that's a constitutional provision, that if you've served in a position like Raila Odinga or have been a deputy president or vice president, those benefits are supposed to accrue to that office. But at the end of the day, when you look at that handshake, then it's very clear that the two principal beneficiaries was President Kenyatta, and right now Raila Odinga is dancing all the way to South Africa in his new role. But the question remains, those people who invested resources and emotions in Raila Odinga's idea, where are they? Is he giving them a direction? Mm-hmm. Where is Baby Pendo? Where are the victims of the post-election violence? All those people whose properties went up in flames, people who lost their lives. Is there going to be restitution? The folks from my village in Musyoka who went to the local banks and got consumer loans to fund this campaign, what is Raila going to give them in return? Mm-hmm. What will be his contribution?
Sure.
So I think those are the questions that remains unanswered. And obviously, mm-hmm. they're very tricky questions. When you speak to people within ODM, they like to ask these questions, but they don't have the guts because they may suffer. You know, there'll be political consequences. Mm-hmm. But I think as a nation now, we should graduate and start looking at our politicians right in their eyes and ask them deep questions. That during the last year's general election, these are the promises you made. Did you deliver them? If you did not deliver, what has happened? And one thing that Raila Odinga has forgotten, I hope it's not conveniently, mm-hmm. is the little matter of IBC. The last couple of days, he's been very quiet on IBC, and one would expect that he would be spending a lot of energies. Because in my view, all the issues you have today about corruption mm-hmm. can actually be tackled if the IBC is very solid. That you've got politicians who've assumed office, they've not been rigged into office, they've not bought their way into office, and they know they've got unquestionable mandate from the people, and they can start killing corruption right from the grassroots.
Mm-hmm. Mark, help me, and of course Kenyans understand this. What is happening in our political scene? Are we finally engaging in mature politics? Because, for example, Mombasa Governor Ali Hassan Joho is on record having already invited the president to Mombasa. This is a man who is very vocal against the president before. Kingi Emerson is now warming up towards Deputy President William Ruto. I think we'll have those sounds but shortly. And then Joho seems to have engaged in some sort of a political bromance with Gideon Moi. I mean, what is going on?
The reality of the matter is our concept of political competition in this country was always one of bitter rivalry and utter enmity. Mm-hmm. Our imagination of opposition is if Uhuru says the sky is blue, then Raila must respond that no, it is black. And that has been the nature of what we've imagined political opposition to be about. Yet the reality of the matter is political opposition is only supposed to come into play when you differ differ in terms of opinion or direction, which in the terms of what is best for the nation, 90% of the time you're supposed to agree. For example, we all agree that corruption is something we need to fight. For example, we all agree that tribalism is something we need to fight. Mm-hmm. And in those instances, whether you are Joho or you're William Ruto or you're Uhuru Kenyatta or you are Oparanya for all intents and purposes, on those matters, as a nation, we need to agree. In the United States, they call it bipartisan approaches on very many issues, and that's where we should be. Secondly, the idea that opposition is dead because Raila Odinga shook hands with Uhuru, it is the same kind of thinking that is giving people like Miguna legs, because Miguna has no legs to stand on. Let's start here. Miguna's case in court, in as much as the courts ruled that Matiang'i and his ilk were out of order, they were fined and found culpable for their crime. Mm-hmm. So as far as the courts are concerned, justice on the side of those in the government has been served. Mm-hmm. Therefore, Miguna, what he's doing today in spewing the vitriol and calling names to everyone, is he's fueling that idea among very silly Kenyans, and I'm not ashamed to call them that, mm-hmm. because it is silly for you to think that opposition is the constant abuse and disagreement of anyone that is in power. Mm-hmm. If Uhuru Kenyatta is building 1 million homes, what are you opposing? If Uhuru Kenyatta is saying universal health care, what are you opposing? If Uhuru Kenyatta is saying I'm fighting corruption, what exactly is it you are opposing?
Maybe they can have a disagreement on the approach,
Yes, disagree about mm-hmm. approach, mm-hmm. but do not wholesale abuse people and say that this is what opposition is about. And this is the maturity that we need. If Hillary Clinton, you listen to her today, beat her rivals with Donald Trump, but does she use the kind of vitriols that we have? Absolutely not. And Bernie Sanders, opposed to Donald Trump, completely. But is he abusive in his approach? Does he agree when Trump is right? For example, the summit on North Korea, I personally dislike Trump a lot, mm-hmm. but he's a president who's finally managed to put North Koreans on a table mm-hmm. and avert nuclear
They're
war.
They're even exchanging letters, apparently.
Yes, mm-hmm. like him or not, yes. he's doing mm-hmm. the right thing. And that's where we need to get to. Political competition does not mean enmity. Mm-hmm. And let's be honest, you should have seen how embarrassed our leaders were when they had to admit about the names they called each other. You remember the president nearly blushed when the former prime minister said, used to call me Mundu Mugoroki. And that is the kind of thing we must stop mm-hmm. in this country.
Mm-hmm. Esbon, are we finally engaging in mature politics, or what do you read in this handshake and the extended handshakes to the two gentlemen, that is Deputy President William Ruto and Kalonzo Musyoka?
But I think I've been a big fan of the handshake, and it is increasingly becoming clear that the handshake is a good thing, and mm-hmm. it is roping almost everyone. You know, the deputy president and the former vice president, we've seen Kiraitu Murungi and Peter Munya. And what it tells you is that there's something that these people are communicating to the electorate, which I'm not so sure they understand. But they're essentially telling us that in a political contest, focus on issues, avoid individual battles. Because when these individuals make up, you'd be left, you know, with an egg on your face. So Kenyans are actually learning a lot from this handshake. And then when you look at what is happening to the Right Honorable Raila Odinga and the fact that he has elevated himself to the position of an elder statesman, for instance, in mm-hmm. Africa and Kenya particularly, I want to believe that even if it was Hesbon Owila who had done whatever Raila Odinga has done mm-hmm. for this country, it would be quite obvious that that is just the next step. Somebody's going to take for the things that he has done. I mean,
are you hinting to a fact that he's under exiting, this position?
I'm not saying, I mean, that one Raila can answer, you know, but what I understand is that he has reached the apex of his political career uh-huh. and he can only ascend to a position that is either equivalent to the president or a role that is sure. beyond this country. Mm-hmm. And I must admit that if there's anyone who's going to be an envoy from Kenya and articulate African issues, I think Raila has earned that position. Mm-hmm. And then secondly, I think talking about the handshake that is now trickling down to the governors here and there, and people wanting to work with different people. There's a generation of politicians that is probably on its twilight, and mm-hmm. I think two of them who are exiting the political scene naturally as competitors are likely to be Raila Amolo Odinga and President Uhuru Kenyatta. And there's a sense in which even the people who are supporting them must now find a way of realigning. And that is what is happening. And it's good for a democracy. And it's also good that President Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila Odinga say that working together or collaborating does not necessarily mean unanimity. Mm-hmm. So when we see Joho and Gideon Moi, Joho and President Uhuru Kenyatta, it's a question of collaborating in the interest of the public and allowing the public now to shape the narratives of our politics. Because mm-hmm. eventually, people will align themselves, not because of the leaders that they want, but because of where the public interest is. Mm-hmm. The folks in central Kenya, Mount Kenya region, or in Nyanza, who are aligning themselves with the deputy president, they're not doing that because they like the deputy president. They're actually doing that because the people in their hometown are receptive to the deputy president. And therefore, if you align yourself to the deputy president, you are likely to boost your political capital. And I think it's happening for politicians across the country. People mm-hmm. are beginning to listen to the masses, and the masses understand that there is some shift in geopolitics, you know, and I think it's a good thing if Kenyans keep watching this political space mm-hmm. so that we don't articulate our politics along individuals, but we articulate them along issues.
Mm-hmm. This must, as much as we're referring to all these developments as, you know, some sort of a political maturity in Kenya finally, is it right to describe it as some sort of a political realignment come 2022?
That probability does exist. But more important in these handshakes, maybe the question we should be asking ourselves is, mm-hmm. what informs that these handshakes? Are these handshakes consistent with our national interest and our public interest? Or are they just informed by the politicians, most of the time, selfish interest to accumulate political capital just for the purposes of winning an election? And what is missing in these handshakes is a very structured thinking. And you know, we've had all handshakes, all manner of handshakes, and Raila Odinga and the president spoke about that, that there was a de Klerk and Mandela. But before the Mandela and de Klerk handshake took place, they were structured behind the room conversations that this handshake is going to take place. And this handshake was an accumulation of people's interest and aspiration. And one hopes that this is where the current handshake between President Kenyatta and Raila Odinga is going to go. That is going to represent the cumulative interests and aspirations of all Kenyans. That it doesn't merely serve their selfish interest. Now, you have politicians all over doing the handshakes, which is very good for optics. But does it cure our societal ills? That's the question we are supposed to ask mm-hmm. ourselves. That this handshake, is it just going to be, like, for instance, if somebody has got malaria and you want to treat malaria, you can use a painkiller till the cows come home, but the person will never heal. You have to look for something similar to malaria queen, if it still does exist.
Yeah.
So these handshakes, are they structured? Are they influenced by our interests and aspirations as a nation? Then at this stage, you go back to the gazettement of the members of that handshake team. They've been given 1 year. And you recall, before the gazettement, there were two political factions in Kenya. One group was saying, I'm going to support a referendum. Another one said, I'm not going to support a referendum. Never mind. There was no question posed. Now we have this task force, an advisory task force, which has been given 1 year to give out the results. And Raila Odinga said yesterday that it depends on the recommendations. So if the recommendations are that we need the constitutional amendments, we'll go for a referendum. Believe you me, even people who have not spent time thinking about this issue, mm-hmm. if they like Raila Odinga, they're going to support it. If they don't like Raila Odinga, they're going to oppose it. So for me, when you talk about political maturity, we'll only attain that political maturity when our political competition is around ideas and philosophies. Mm-hmm. For instance, Mark Bishash has indicated if the president wants to put up 1 million units, of mm-hmm. course, you'll give him a pat on the back. But we must go and interrogate that question. Mm-hmm. What kind of building technology are we going to use? What kind of housing are we going to come up with? And in my view, if you've got a divergent view from mm-hmm. the president or the deputy president or even these leaders, that's not merely opposition by the side. It's very constructive opposition,
yes.
because it must be known yes. to all and sundry mm-hmm. that there's nobody who has got monopoly of knowledge. Mm-hmm. That's why you've got the National Assembly, Senate, County Assemblies, where people go debate. If you've got yes. a good idea, you throw mm-hmm. it for discussion.
Sure, and I think Mark has already alluded to the fact that, you know, you can disagree, but you can disagree in a mature,
yes.
in a mature manner. Let's talk about Kalonzo Musyoka, Mark, because there are those who are saying, during the extended handshake, that is during the prayer meeting on Thursday, that has given him some sort of, you know, a chance to revive himself politically. Do you think that's the case? Or do you think he came into the handshake because of the pressures within his Wiper party?
You know, there's an English saying that says, cometh the hour, cometh the man. And the question has to be, the hour indeed is at hand, but is Kalonzo the man? That's the question. Because one of the things that I've realized about the Kenyan political class, they're such creatures of habit that once you change their environment, they do not know how to participate in the political discourse. I'll give you an example. Ever since the handshake, there are certain politicians in both ODM and Jubilee and who cannot say a thing because their expertise was in dreaming up abuses based on people's tribal lineage. And as such, you find yourself completely irrelevant and unable to participate. Kalonzo Musyoka, though not known for vitriol, is one who's suffering because his way of politics was always to play the watermelon card. I'm neither hot nor cold. Guess what? The waters have become warm. Mm. And there is no space really for Kalonzo if he continues in the mold and form he has been in the past to move forward. If Kalonzo cannot reinvent himself, he can have 6 million handshakes. He has no chance in 2022. What needs to happen if his strategists are listening? He needs to be baptized anew. He needs to come out of the Jordan leprosy free and willing to take on the challenge of this republic. Without that, I'm telling you, cometh the hour, cometh the man, but Kalonzo is not the man.
Hezbon? We've had that interesting analogy from
it is,
from
it is, it is interesting. And without even going into Kalonzo, I must say that the politics of this country at the moment revolve around three people, you know. President Uhuru Kenyatta, Raila Amolo Odinga, and William Samoei Arap Ruto. And therefore, to the extent that you're not part of this triumvirate, you are actually outside. And I think Kalonzo is one politician who will fight so many battles because he knows how to emerge. And I think he found a niche in the handshake and is back to the national political relevance. So to speak, that now we cannot speak without talking about Kalonzo Musyoka because he's part of these three politicians. But I think having said that, it's so important to note that looking at the constitution that we have today, you know, the dominant role of the opposition that we had in 1992, after the 1992 general election and after the 2002 general election, is non-existent. It doesn't matter what President Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila Amolo Odinga do. I think parliament is detached from the executive. And if you look at the parliamentary committees, they are made up of MPs from across the board. And what these handshakes are doing, even at the county level, is that they are giving MPs and legislators, even at the county assembly, the opportunity now to voice issues based on the interests of the people that they represent. Mm-hmm. So that if you find anyone who was vocal before the handshake and right now they are mute, it is because they were not articulating anything that was in the interest of the public. Mm-hmm. This is the time that President Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila Odinga have agreed to work together, but that does not mean unanimity. Mm-hmm. So if there is anything that comes to the floor of the House that you don't agree with as an individual who represents a constituency, mm-hmm. now you can articulate it with the objectivity that it deserves. And given the environment that has been created, I want to believe that Parliament should be a lot more robust in its oversight role and its legislative role. And if they fail, they're failing because they've been part and parcel of this politics of patronage, mm-hmm. which is non-existent. From where I see it, I think we are moving to a dispensation where it doesn't matter who is at the top, because if they're working together, then it means that they're serving the interest of the people. And if you are a representative, you also ought to serve the interest of the people.
Mm-hmm. And we're almost out of time, Dismas. Let me just give you a minute to react to that. I saw you shaking your head before you take the break.
Because Professor Willa almost committed a fallacy when he says that Parliament is now detached from the executive. That cannot be the case. You recall during the start of this current session, a number of MPs who describe themselves as liberals decided to go campaign for those committee positions. Mm-hmm. They won the seats. A few days later, a number of parliamentary group meetings were called, and either they were forced to resign, step down, or they were kicked out. So one cannot accurately say that the National Assembly today as constituted, as well as the Senate, can operate without a direction from President Kenyatta, President Kenyatta, Ruto, and Raila Odinga. Most of those MPs have got the fear of Lord in their system. They cannot take a position mm-hmm. till they've seen some signals coming from other quarters.
That was entirely before the handshake.
This is, yeah.
But right now, uh-huh. what we are saying is, now that position is converging. Mm-hmm. The position taken by both State House mm-hmm. and the perceived, you know, other side is now converging.
Yes.
And that's what I'm saying.
Sure. Mark, we're going to continue with this conversation. Of course, it's exactly 27 minutes past 12 p.m. Of course, this is the Sunday edition right in KTN News. We're going to still continue with some of the conversations that has been taking place during the week, politically speaking, including how Deputy President Ruto responded to President Uhuru Kenyatta's Kutangatanga remarks. For our viewers in Rwanda and parts of Burundi who don't speak Swahili, we're going to translate that for you. We're going to be right back. Stay with us.